Willie, it's a joy to have you here in our little town. I often say to folks, if you come to Alexandria, Indiana, you have come on purpose.
Yeah.
But it's good to have you here.
Good to be with you, my friend.
You've been here before, haven't you?
Oh, yes, yeah, yes. I recorded here, and I just love being with you, Bill. It's a joy.
How far does our relationship go back? Maybe 20, 30?
Oh, yeah.
30 years?
From back in the days of Indianapolis, I'm sorry, where we did the praise gatherings in Indianapolis. It goes back a long time.
Yeah. You know, you are part of a special fraternity of a young man who obviously loved music. For all of us who grew up and music got our attention.
Yes.
And in some cases, even got our attention as far as the message of Jesus is concerned.
Yes.
We so loved the art form and the music, and we said, hey, wait, what are they singing about, you know?
Right,
They're singing about Jesus.
Yes.
But you are part of this fraternity that may have started out in music, but you wanted to pursue something else.
Sure.
And anybody who's been around you certainly knows that you love life, you love education, you
yes.
love learning,
yes.
you love teaching.
Yes.
And it didn't take you long to say, I can do a certain thing through music,
right?
But I can do a lot more on a given occasion with the spoken word.
Absolutely.
Is that true?
Absolutely correct. I'm going to take you back just a little bit. When I was about 14 and a half years old, my voice changed. I woke up one morning with this sound coming out of my throat. It messed up my father, if you can imagine your 14-year-old kid saying, hey, Dad, how you doing? You
know.
Now, this is in the 60s, so I wanted to be another Sly Stone. You probably have no idea who that is.
Oh, yes. It was Sly Stone and
Sly and the Family Stone.
Sly and the Family Stone.
Right. But I met Sly, and he was stoned. And I said, no, something's wrong with this picture. My hero is incoherent, you know. That's not where I want to end up. And I found another musical hero at the time. Because I didn't have any voice teachers. But, Bill, I found my voice teacher on the radio. So I'm 15 years old with this voice, and I'm listening, close the door, get a pencil, and I'm practicing sounding like this voice coming over the radio. So for my 34th wedding anniversary, I said to my wife, my voice teacher on the radio, I wonder if he's still in concert. So I Googled, and lo and behold, he was in concert. So I bought plane tickets and concert tickets. Something told me, send him a message. So I sent him an email. I said, sir, when I was 15, my voice changed. I didn't have any voice teachers, but you became my voice teacher on the radio. That's how I learned to sing. You have been my musical inspiration, my musical North Star. And then I said, I want to tell you all I've gone on to do with that inspiration. And I shared with him how, at the time, I'd sung for 6 presidents of the United States, and I was the only soloist at Diana Ross's wedding in Switzerland, and the last one to sing Amazing Grace for Mother Teresa before she died, you know. I said, I may not get to see you, but I want to thank you. I got an email back from him saying, Sir Tom Jones would like to see you and your wife when you come to Las Vegas.
So the guy was Tom Jones.
That's how I learned to sing. So when I walked into the green room, his eyes went really big because I said, it's not unusual to be loved by anyone. You know? And so that was my first foray into using this voice. And of course, I heard other voices like Paul Robeson and, you know, great bass baritone singers, William Warfield, who sang Old Man River, you know. I said, wow, that's what you could do with this, you know. And then I went to a Christian school for my last year of high school. in Oshawa, Canada. That's where I grew up. I grew up in Montreal, Canada. And that's outside of Toronto.
Okay, yeah.
And I didn't like it at first because they had too many rules and regulations for me. You know, all the lights got turned out at a certain hour. You couldn't hold hands with the girls on campus and, you know, stuff like that. And I went to the dean of men and I said, I can't take all these rules. I said, I'm leaving. He said, is that what you really want to do? I said, yeah. He said, why don't you do for once? Not what you want to do, but what God wants you to do. And that's when I went up to my room. For the first time in my life, I prayed that I remember praying. And I said, God, whatever you want me to do, I'll do. I said, if you want me to be a garbage man, for you, I'm willing to be a garbage man. If the only music I'll know is whistling hymns on the back of a garbage truck, that's fine. And then I said, God, you know I'd like to travel and use my talents for you. If that's your will for me, open the doors. Let me see in some way. A day went by, a couple of men came up to me and said, are you Wintley Phipps? I said, yeah. He said, we've been hearing about you. We want you to travel and do singing evangelism with us. They said, we're from a group called the Heritage Singers and the Heritage Family. And I said, wow.
Well, they sang a bunch of Gaither songs.
Oh, yes, they did.
What was his name, Max?
Max Mace.
Max, what a good man.
And then, so I tell people when you get your first prayer answered, it scars you for life because it lets you know there is a God and he is real and he hears and answers prayer. And as I walk the campus of that school, recognizing that there is a God and I'm in deep conviction, I'm listening now. And Bill, I heard a voice that I now know as God speak to my heart saying, I've seen your dreams. Now give me your dreams. And I'll let you glimpse a little of what I've been dreaming for you.
And for you, it was a struggle to figure out, and you can call it anything, God's will for your life or any of that.
Yeah.
But one of the biggest questions I get, and I'm sure you get, is from young artists.
Yes.
I've got this. What can I do with it? And you don't want to be discouraging to them at all, but you do want them to be realistic.
Right. God gave me a quote that I share because I tell a lot of the stories of what God has done in my life. And sometimes people don't realize I just tell the story because in every story, God gets the glory.
Yeah.
When you're blessed with a good wife, that helps to keep your equilibrium. You know, somebody who can really tell you the way it is. And I've been blessed. I've been married for 47 years. And I've got a good wife, spiritual lady who loves the Lord and loves me enough to tell me when I'm off base. And that's a blessing. But what I wanted to tell you in answer to your question, like you, I've reached the pinnacle of so many experiences. I mean, when you're on television and you're doing two songs, and ABC, CBS, NBC, Fox, CNN, and everybody's covering you at the same time, it is an amazing opportunity. Or Promise Keepers, you know, when you got 60,000 men in front of you, you know. So I've done Saturday Night Live. There's no one I could have ever wanted to meet, Bill, that I haven't met. No place in the world, every continent of the world except Antarctica. I've taken my family in ministry with me. All five of us have been to the Great Wall of China and Africa and South America and Papua New Guinea and places, and it has been amazing. But here's what I want to tell you that I share with young artists. I tell them all those amazing experiences, those are moments of destiny. And I say moments of destiny are moments for which you were created, but they're not the reason for which you were created. The reason for which you were created is to grow more every day, to resemble, reflect, and reveal the character of God in your life. I've sung for Democrats, Independents, Republicans. As a matter of fact, I'll tell you one funny thing. One day I had to sing at a big function in Washington where President Clinton spoke. You know, I've sung for President Reagan, President Bush, seven of the last eight presidents. So I'm singing at this function where President Clinton spoke, and the same night, I had to rush across town and sing at this big Republican function. And when I got there, I announced that I had just come from singing for the President of the United States, and there was this boo and rumbling that went through the audience. I said, wait a minute. I said, I always go where people really need the Lord. And there was this polite applause, and then I said, and that's why I'm here, you know.
So you have had a lot of opportunities to speak to believers, non-believers.
I've been blessed to reach some of the most amazing people. One day I was singing in Baltimore, Maryland, and I came down off the platform and I felt a tap on my shoulder. The young lady said, "Excuse me, sir, I just heard you sing. I'm really discouraged." She was about to be fired, really. She was making $25,000 a year on her job. She said, "I feel like I can talk to you. Do you have time to talk to me?" I said, "Sure." So she came by our home. We talked and prayed together. And after praying with her, I said, "You know, before you go, God has impressed me to tell you He's going to bless you and give you an opportunity to speak to millions of people." She sat up, she said, "You think God would do that for me?" And it was Oprah Winfrey. Yeah. And that's how we met all those years ago. Yeah. And God has had me ministering to people of all political, all stripes, because we all need the Lord. Yeah. And whatever we can do to help make our nation a nation of Christians is the most important thing we can do to help America.
I've asked crowds before, when have you learned the best? When you were winning or when you were losing?
Whoa.
I had a friend, Kent Benson, who used to play, who was on the 76 championship Indiana University team. And he stopped by the house a couple summers ago. My grandson loves to shoot three-pointers.
Yes.
And he's really pretty good. He's just a freshman in high school. Mm-hmm. But I said, "Okay, Kent, do you have any advice for my young grandson?"
Uh-huh.
He didn't take very much time, but he finally said, "Either win or learn."
Win or learn. Oh, my. Beautiful.
I had not heard that. Yes. You know, I had not heard that before.
Yes.
But it seems like our learning points in life are not when we're knocking it out of the ballpark.
Isn't that something? Yeah. As a matter of fact, another wonderful quote God gave me, and I shared it. Some years ago, I was on an Eastern Airlines flight from Los Angeles to Atlanta. And my wife recognized this lady on the plane. And so I went and I got a cassette. That's how long ago it was, right?
Now you're dating yourself.
Yeah, right. And I knelt down beside her and I said, "You know, the Lord has impressed me to come talk to you. I'm a gospel singer and inspirational artist. And there's a song on this tape, this cassette tape, called Lord, I Give You My Life." And she said, "Thank you." I said, "I want you to listen to it." She said, "Thank you so much." She said, "I travel with a cassette player." Remember when the Walkman was like the rage?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And she said, "Thank you so much. God bless you." When the plane landed in Atlanta, she was standing in the jetway waiting for me. She took my hand. She squeezed it. Her eyes were misty. She had a beautiful smile. She said, "Thank you so much." She said, "God bless you. God bless you." The lady was Natalie Wood, a few days before she drowned. And when I heard that she had drowned, I was shaken because I knew without a doubt that it was not by accident that God had allowed our paths to cross.
Yeah.
And God gave me a quote that it is in the quiet crucible of our personal private sufferings that our noblest dreams are born and God's greatest gifts are given. And often God gives his greatest gifts in compensation for what we've been through. You know, she was going through some difficult times at that time.
Yeah.
And it's when, it takes my breath away, it's when we are going through some of our most difficult days that our hearts are most open to the love of God, to the grace of God. A man called me up one day. He said, I want you to sing this song about giving your life to God that you sing. I want you to sing it on Soul Train. And I said, how's this man going to get me on Soul Train? So he called up Don Cornelius, the host. He said, I want you to put this young man on Soul Train. Don Cornelius said, I'm sorry, I can't put anything religious on Soul Train. He said, what? You know, all you got is young people dressed funny and bumping into each other. And what this young man is trying to say in his music, those are the very young people who need to hear it. Don Cornelius said, I'm sorry, I can't put anything religious on Soul Train. The man said, listen, Don, my name is George Johnson of Johnson Products Company, you know, Ultra Sheen, Afro Sheen, and my company's been backing your show for the last 8 years. Next thing I knew, I was the first gospel artist on Soul Train.
That turned him around pretty quickly.
Yeah, that's right, that's right. So, and by the way, I'll tell you, I have a little secret personal dream that I carry in my heart, Bill. That one day I'll be in heaven. I dream about it. Working on my mansion with my holy hammer, right? Like if there'll be something broke that needs to be fixed, right? And I'll hear a knock on the door. And when I open it, Jesus will be standing there.
Yeah.
Clothed in light, crown of glory on his head. And he'll say to me, my son, I'm about to go to some parts of my universe where they've never seen a child from earth who has been redeemed. And I want you to come go with me. Oh, and by the way, I want you to sing just before I speak. That's the dream I carry in my heart, Bill. And can you imagine the Lord saying, okay, I want you to sing for the angels or sing for this group. What song would you sing?
Yeah.
And that's why some of those great...
I hope it would be a Gaither tune. that just flipped into my mind. Wintley, I love to read biographies.
Yes.
The vocal band did a trip to South Africa.
Okay.
In the 90s, after apartheid was over.
Yes.
And then we also went down to the very tip,
yes,
to Robben Island.
Wow, did you get there?
And went through the prison, saw the small little cell that Nelson Mandela was incarcerated in for, 30 years?
27 years.
27 years.
Yes.
Amazing story, and I saw the book, The Long Road to Freedom.
Yes.
900 pages, and because of arthritis, that was a heavy book to hold up.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah,
I think the next time I'll read that on Kindle.
Right.
But I was so infatuated by his character.
Yes.
His integrity.
Yes.
His patience. His long suffering.
Right. Forgiveness.
Forgiveness. And you met him.
Yeah. February 8, 1990, I landed in Johannesburg.
Yeah.
February 9th, the following day, we were in the offices of President F.W. de Klerk, the president of the country, in his offices in Cape Town.
Yeah.
And after, you know, the normal chit-chat, he looked at us and said, you've come a long way to tell us apartheid is wrong. And then he said, but I want you to know you're preaching to the choir. We know it's wrong. He said, we need time. We need time to change. Well, he didn't tell us in that meeting that the next day he had a secret meeting with Nelson Mandela to inform him suddenly that the following day, He was going before the press to announce that he would be released the next day. So, Bill, as a consequence, I was in the crowd that welcomed Nelson Mandela when he came out of prison.
Yeah.
It was jubilant. It was electric. It was amazing. And of course, everyone was on pins and needles because we all knew that the future of this nation, whether it went up in flames or whether it would have a chance to go a path that was peaceful, all depended upon what Nelson Mandela would say.
Yeah.
And when he got up that day, I'll never forget it. I can see the place now, him standing there, and we're all packed in. I was really one of the most frightened that I'd ever been. I'd never been in a crowd, you know, 100, 200,000 people, and you're all crammed in. But when he gave that speech where he called for forgiveness, where he let this country know, and all his comrades, as they called them, know that we are moving in a path of love and respect for every human being, it changed the course of this nation.
Oh, absolutely.
And Nelson Mandela is one of those amazing human beings that God placed in this earth.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. One day, I was on an Amtrak train from Baltimore to Philadelphia. And on Amtrak, when you don't want someone sitting next to you, you learn how to camp out and put your papers and your food around you, and you try to send the message, please find someplace else to sit, you know? So this man had camped out, but he looked really discouraged. I looked into his eyes, he looked really low, and there were other seats available, but I walked up to him and I said, is anybody sitting next to you? And he smiled, he said, no, and he pulled up his papers and his briefcase, and it was Chuck Colson. And we became dear friends from that train ride. And he began to take me into the prisons with him to sing. And he would speak and I would sing. I'll never forget being in a prison in Marion, Florida one day with him. It was an Easter Sunday morning, and I sang at the men's prison. And then we went over to the women's prison. I sang Amazing Grace over there. When I finished, a young lady came up to me, pregnant, about to have her baby in prison, tears in her eyes. She said, excuse me, sir. She said, your wife named Linda. I said, yes. She said, that's my aunt. We didn't know that my wife's brother's daughter was in prison and about to have a baby in prison. And then we started looking at the family dynamics. All of my wife's seven brothers and sisters have been incarcerated for some length of time at some point in their lives. Her older sister had six children. Five of them have been in prison. And then we began to see this, what we call this intergenerational cycle of incarceration. Almost 60% or more of children who end up going to prison come from the children of those who are in prison. Yep. And so Chuck was so kind, he placed me on his board of directors for the Prison Fellowship Ministries. And that's where I learned how you build and run ministry with integrity. I don't know of another ministry that I respect more for how they've been run over the years than Prison Fellowship, but I learned how it was done. And when this statistic surfaced, that it's the children of prisoners we need to focus on, the children of those who are in prison, I began to advocate on the board, let's build ministry to help these kids. You know, the Angel Tree kids, the kids who get gifts at Christmas.
We've been part of that for
years. Yes, it's what do you do with them all year long? And so I began to say, let's build ministry for them. And Chuck said, you know, this is a calling for you. He mentored me. He said, we'll help you get started. And they got me my first office space, first employee. And this year, Bill, it's 25 years that we first started the first real ministry of its kind that provides tutoring, character building, which is really how you build Christ-like character. Yeah. It's character building.
Yeah.
And mentoring, we provide that after school to children whose parents are incarcerated. And interestingly enough, children falling behind in school.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, the family is still at the foundation of a healthy community, a healthy church, and a healthy nation. Winston Churchill was one of my great heroes, and he basically had a quote that I carry, that a loving mother, a caring father, in a healthy relationship, raising children. And his quote was, "No superior alternative has been found."
what a great quote.
Yeah. We haven't found anything more effective and anything better. And when the family disintegrates, that's when the enemy is able to do his worst work.
I have such a heart for the black culture for some reason. Yes. And I think it's mainly the music and the food.
Yeah.
But in fact, in this very room, we did a video of black gospel music of the greats.
Yes, I remember that.
How can we make a difference in the black community?
So one of the things that people often don't factor in is the family experience of African Americans. African Americans were the only people group who did not come to this country as families.
Yeah.
Nor did they have extended family like every other immigrant group to strengthen the family that was already here. Many of the families they tried to start were sold, broken off. And so there has been this legacy of woundedness in the family that has never really healed. There have been times of spiritual revival and renaissance where the families have come closer together. But God gave me a quote once that storms always take out trees with the weakest roots first. And so—
Boy, that is true.
So what happens is the families that have the weakest roots, when the storms of crime and drugs and divorce and all the societal storms, when they are raging and they're coming through communities, they're tearing up the trees that have the weakest roots. So the question is, how do we revive? How do we strengthen? And really, it's not just for black families. Any time you see a lot of crime in a white community or any other community, you can trace it right back to family disintegration. Those are not strong families. Education is part of the answer. The biggest part of the answer is building character.
Yeah.
The biggest part of the answer is building character. And so in our ministry, we focus on character building and through mentoring. And again, when a child is learning to read and a child is learning academics, that's an exercise in character building. When a child recognizes that there's so much I've got to learn and I'm willing to embrace learning. Character is everything. And I ask God, show me your character. And God showed me and led me to his divine plan for the development of Christian character. I didn't know there was one until I found it in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 through 7. There are 8 key dimensions of character that God says in His Word, make sure you have these eight. And they are faith. Faith is the ability to believe. In other words, the ability to have a strong belief is necessary for good character.
Yeah.
He said, virtue, add to your faith virtue. Virtue is moral goodness, moral integrity. So he says, these are the eight, faith, virtue, and this is knowledge. Learning, the ability to be open to learn. Faith, virtue, knowledge. And then he says, self-control. Self-control. You cannot have character without self-control. Yeah.
And the anger level with our culture at this point at the highest ever. The road rage.
That's right.
You make a simple little mistake on turning and some guy got his window down yelling and say, man, this is not a life or death issue.
Right.
Yes,
right.
I shouldn't have cut in front or whatever. I don't understand the anger, do you?
I don't know. But without character, that's what you have.
Yeah.
So self-control. The fifth one is patience. That'll stop a lot of road rage, won't it?
Absolutely.
Patience. Patience is a key aspect of character. It's the reason young kids get pregnant.
Yeah.
You know, you can't wait.
Yeah.
You know, impatience. And then the next one is godliness, which is godlikeness, which is a commitment to be godlike in character and a respect, get this, for what is holy, for what you know is holy. Do you have a sacredness for what is holy? And then the last two, number seven is kindness.
Yeah.
Kindness. We don't see a lot of character in our politicians. And one of the reasons is we don't see a lot of kindness.
And
of course, the last dimension of character of these eight that God says in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 5 through 7, is love or charity. Love.
Let me throw out something here, speaking of the character of God.
Yes.
Gloria and I have been discussing a lot because we're both in our 80s.
Yes.
60-year marriage.
Wonderful.
And we kind of smile and look at the younger generation and say, I'm not sure you really know what intimacy is all about.
Oh.
Back to the enemy.
Yes.
Hollywood. I don't think Hollywood's the enemy. Yeah. I think some good things can come out of Hollywood.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I think at the same time, the secular world has given us a bad picture of what real intimacy is.
Yeah.
And technically, that's one of God's, I think, biggest purposes on earth, to develop intimacy with us.
You mean Him with us?
Absolutely.
God's intimacy with us, yes.
And when that happens, I really think, I mean, suicide's a big thing now.
Yes,
depression.
It is.
And I think one of the reasons it's true is people are seeking, like they've never sought before, intimacy.
Yes.
Last night, Gloria and I were in our kitchen by ourselves with our dog, Windsor.
Yes, yes.
And a fire in a fireplace.
Yeah.
Eating supper together.
Yeah, yeah. An old black preacher taught me something one day. He said, Phipps, he said, I've learned how to pray every hour on the hour. And I said, wow, to myself, how do you do that? How do you have that kind of discipline? And so I need a little help to do that. So back in the 80s, I'd buy these cheap watches that would vibrate every hour. And they would remind me to pause center myself and pray
and
say a little prayer. And now I actually developed a little personal app for my family. I guess now the whole world know about it. But I have a little personal app called Divine Alerts. And every hour, it feeds me something from the scriptures. It centers me. A little hour, I get a notification, and it reminds me to pray. And I remember reading where someone once said that it was God's will that our whole lives be an unbroken communion with Himself. You know, sometimes we think, you're in music, so you'll understand this. You go to a symphony, and you hear these great grand passages, and then these quiet moments, and then it goes back to these big, dynamic grand passages. And we think of life as a symphony of activity punctuated by moments of intimacy and quiet, when and communion with God, when we really ought to turn it upside down, and we need to begin to see our whole lives as a communion with God, punctuated by distractions. And when the distractions are over, go back to that intimacy, go back to that quiet. And you can train your mind and your heart to have constant, hourly, unbroken communion and intimacy with God. And it is a beautiful way to live. You know, I almost could have started this interview with one of the most important stories of my life. I was at home, and an aunt came to visit me who I hadn't seen in years. And she was walking around the house looking at all the pictures with all the presidents and you know, Oprah and Mrs. King and Rosa Parks. And she sees all these pictures with President Reagan. And she says, "Sit down, I want to tell you something." So I sat down and she said, "Your father, my brother, 2 years before you were born, we had a sister named Pearl who died while having an abortion, getting rid of an unwanted pregnancy. And when your mother became pregnant with you outside of wedlock, there were some who were urging her to do the same. But we, some of us gathered, rallied around your mother to say, no, we went through too much pain losing our sister. We don't want anything like this to happen again. And then your mother's mother came up and paid a visit to our mother, your father's mother, and they closed the door to talk about this situation. And they made a pact that they would pray for the life of this child. And they decided the prayer that they were going to pray is, Lord, make this child's life a blessing to the world. And so, Bill, all that's happened in my life, all the places that I've gone, all the audiences that I've sung to, meeting you, working with you, you have been a blessing to my ministry in ways that I cannot begin to count. And I could never find the words to express to you and Gloria my gratitude, my love. You opened doors for me. But what I want you to see is that what you did and what God has done in my life and ministry,
okay,
it's an answer to two grandmothers' prayers.
that's a wonderful story. That's a wonderful story. Mm-hmm. Wintley, one of these days, life as we know it here on earth is going to be over for both of us.
That's correct.
And some folks are going to say something about you.
Yeah.
What would you like for them to say?
I would like for them to say that here was a child who really loves Jesus. Yeah. One of the songs that I'm singing, and I've been enjoying singing it, is an old Negro spiritual. Talk about a child that do love Jesus.
Here's one.
Here's one. I would love for them to be able to say, there's one child who loved Jesus so much that he dedicated his life completely to Christ. He tried his best to resemble, reflect, and reveal the character of Christ in his life. And he tried to inspire and motivate as many people as possible to become more like the character of Christ. If I could have that said about me, that's all I need.
Wentley, it's been a joy to have you here today.
You too, my friend. Well, this has been awesome. I thank you for this opportunity to share with you. And please pass on the glory of my gratitude to both of you for your love and support through the years.
We need to do this more often.
I would love to.
Or maybe buy a bus and go on the road.
Okay? All right. That sounds great.
Good to be with you.
Thank you, sir.